would you welcome them? And they're going to share with us the latest.
Good evening, everyone. We are so excited to be here with you tonight. And I would like to ask you to stand together as we join our voices and sing this famous Christmas song, O Come, All Ye Faithful, Joyful and Triumphant. Let's adore our Lord and King Jesus Christ. Amen.
Baby boy, Yeah.
founder and I are going to visit. I'm going to interview him, and he's going to share testimonies so you can know them better and know what it was like for them growing up in Romania. So we've got some stools back here. We're going to sit down and relax. Thank you, Scotty.
Okay, my name is Andre Parvu, my wife Helga Parvu right there, and her sister Maria. We, as Dr. Nick said, we are all of us pastor kids. Our fathers are pastors in Romania. We grew up in Romania, and we were so blessed to have such a great example in our parents. To see their devotion, their passion for serving Christ, and that's more than probably any child would desire for his life. Although when you're young, you think that having a great inheritance like a big house or nice cars is the best thing you can get from your parents. Actually, you get to a point in life when you realize that their example as people leading you on your way and helping you to fall in love with Jesus is actually the great inheritance they can leave to us. And my dad, as I said, my dad is a pastor, and his dad was one of the first Christians in his village during the communism. And he also grew up in a Christian family, my father. And my grandfather, being under the communism, I would like to share this short story with you to understand what a great heritage God gave to me as his grandson. He was one of the first Christians in his village, and you know that the communists didn't like Christians, and they don't want you to go and share the gospel with other people. And my grandfather had kind of a big mouth, as we say. He couldn't keep it quiet, and he wanted to share with other people about Jesus Christ and this joy that we celebrate on Christmas. You know, he was born to bring us salvation. And they warned him, you know, to stop sharing the gospel with other people, and he couldn't stop. So one night they stopped by his house, a police car. They took him in the car, they covered his head so he cannot see where they're gonna take him, and they took him to jail. And he spent 2 years in jail with his wife and kids, knowing nothing about him. They didn't know if he's still alive or not. And while he was there in jail, the communists thought, if we're gonna give him a shot in the brain, he will go mad. And even if, when we release him from jail, if he will continue to share the gospel with other people, nobody will listen to him because they will think he's a crazy man. So they gave him the shot, but guess what? It didn't work out, and he died as a normal person, like a few years ago in his early 90s, and it was such a great example for my dad, for my father, and my father took this great heritage and taught us how to live for Christ. And I remember so clearly what my dad used to tell me so many times when I was young, and that really marked my life in such a strong way. He used to tell me, I would rather be dead 2 meters underground than live this life without serving Jesus Christ. And that was a great example. And those were not only fancy words. That was his life. And us as children, we were able to see that truth in his life daily.
Amen. That's
wonderful.
God bless you.
Amen.
Thank you, Andre. That's wonderful. What a great heritage that you have. Tell us then how you got here, how your family got here. And I know there's a story about Helga getting a scholarship to Southeastern, correct?
Right.
But now she's at the seminary. By the way, Andre is one of my students. He is, for this semester, And him coming tonight is going to help his grade.
That's right.
No, he's been in a couple of my classes and won this semester, in fact. But his brother-in-law, their brother, they have gone out with me sharing the gospel. You know, I've told you that I go door to door in New Orleans, in the Gentilly area and all. They both have been with me to share the gospel. So this is not just a performance thing. They live it. Amen?
Amen.
Isn't that good? Okay, so tell us how you got here. And of all places, to South Louisiana from Romania.
Right.
Okay, tell us
that's
that story.
True. I would like to invite my wife to tell this story because she came here first, so she knows it better than me.
Yes, I did come here 5 years ago, actually, and there is this organization called the Romanian American Mission Board, and they do missions in Romania every year. So they send teams to do with medical equipment and for children's ministry and street evangelism and so forth. So I was one of the doctor's interpreters, and they suggested, hey, how would you like to go study in the United States for your college years? And I was like, yeah, sure, that would be so exciting. And so I was like, yeah, sure, like from Romania to the United States, I mean, hello, it's like over the ocean. So I was like, sure. So I looked at different universities, and one of my friends suggested Southeastern. And next thing I knew, I was just filling out an online application and for the music program. And I also recorded myself playing violin with three classical pieces, some concerts. Of some classical composers, and I sent it over, and they said, okay, we'll give you a full tuition scholarship. Yay! So, I was obviously super excited. And then everything worked out. God provided the plane ticket and everything. It was a huge transition. And it was hard for me the first semester, you know, knowing nobody. All my friends were actually in Mississippi. Because my friends were in Mississippi, that's where I first went when I landed. I traveled to Mississippi, Brandon, actually, and some of my friends there at Brandon Baptist, when they heard me sing and play violin, they're like, hey, how would you like to go to the New Orleans Baptist Theological Seminary down in New Orleans? I was like, sure, I don't know the difference, but whatever. So next thing we know, I didn't even go to Southeastern, like not even one day. So I packed everything and we moved down to New Orleans and they set me up in the girls' dorms and I started school like 3 days later, literally. So it was amazing. I've just graduated with my bachelor's in music with voice and violin performance, and I've just started my master's in marriage and family counseling. I'm very excited, and we have wonderful scholars, and I'm just so grateful and so blessed and so honored that I got this opportunity, and it's just been amazing for me. And next year, I hope my brother Benjamin come. The next year, I got married, so Andre came. And this year, my sister Maria came, and I also have a brother in Oklahoma. There's 7 children in my family, 5 boys and 2 girls, and my dad is also a church planting pastor, and he's been done that for like 24 years now. But that's the short version
of
it.
Thank you so much, Maria. It's a great story. All right. All right, Maria. Tell us, real briefly, are there any different traditions or ways that you celebrate Christmas in Romania? Anything come to mind? Something
yes.
Different? Or
we have snow.
Yeah, there you go. You have a lot of snow, don't you?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a lot colder there, yes.
In Romania, it really begins to look a lot like Christmas. Here, we need to make it. Yeah, so one big thing that I really like about Romanian Christmas. And I've heard that you used to do this here, I might be wrong, to go out and singing carols from door to door.
Yeah. We used to
okay, we still do that in Romania, and it's amazing, it's a great opportunity to share the gospel. People are so open. I mean, you have to be good on Christmas, right? For Christmas, be good for goodness sake, that's what one of the songs is. So everybody's good to you and they open their doors and they open their hearts, and we just use this opportunity and we don't expect something from them, but we actually take with us some calendars that you have a devotional for each day of the year, and we offer them as a gift. So they will have that seed of the word in their houses and they can read daily, and one day we hope that that word of God will work in their hearts and they will come to Christ. And we do that, we also, many times we use the opportunity to pray for them, You know, not everybody's happy on Christmas. So some people go through difficult moments, and many times we had the opportunity to be there for them and just pray with them and just love on them as Christ would do. And yeah, that's the best thing that I really enjoy about Christmas in Romania. And as one thing that I want to mention about the calendars, devotional every day, actually my mom's father came to Christ like that. He used to read those calendars every day for 5 years. And he was so mad and angry on Christians that he used to curse my mom and my grandmother because they used to go to church and all. He was so angry against Christian. And after reading 5 years from those devotionals, one day they found him on his knees in the living room. He was crying. And he was praying to trust his life to Jesus Christ. And that's how he came to Christ.
Amen. Now, Andre's already mentioned this, but you realize, as I mentioned this morning, the dictatorship of Nicolae Ceaușescu was very, very harsh. And he was a very evil leader. And the revolution that started with believers. It started with a Lutheran pastor and his people wanting to protect him from the secret police and those who were coming for him. And two of my heroes of the faith that I personally know, and I've shared this with Andre before, Ion Moldovan was an evangelist and preacher that came out of Romania. And we went to the PhD program together. He's teaching at Southwestern Seminary in Texas. But he's a hero of mine because he was literally persecuted, beaten for his faith by the secret police. And then Peter Dugulescu, who's been in our home and held my girls when they were little babies, he was a leader in the revolution and also became a part of the parliament. I can't remember if he's a senator or something. And he passed away of a heart attack just a few years ago. But two of my heroes are Romanian Christians. And you've already touched on a little bit, but did your parents as well grow up under communism, your parents and grandparents?
Yes.
So what is it different for you and did your parents? Anything else you want to share about that real briefly?
Sure. I mean, it was rough. We know about it from our parents and grandparents. We were babies. I was a baby. They were born after the revolution. And it was kind of tough to live as a Christian. Here, you can tell, it's kind of fancy in America to say I'm a Christian. You know, if you don't say I'm a Christian, it sounds weird. But there, back in, you know, early 80s in Romania, if you would say I'm a Christian, you could go to jail. And not only that, they would hire spies to just spy you and see if you're active in sharing the gospel with other people. My dad, because he was a Christian, he never got a promotion at his job. The reason you're a Christian, you always have to take the trash out, you have to clean the toilets, you have to do the trashy jobs just because you're a Christian, just to humiliate them and to show everybody if you are a Christian or if you think about becoming a Christian, this is what you will have to face. But he has tons of stories what it meant for him to live by faith during those times. And one time, I'll just share this briefly. One morning, he woke up kind of late, and he used to spend at least an hour every morning with the Lord, his quiet time before going to work. And one morning, he woke up late, and he didn't want to miss his quiet time, so he decided, I will have my quiet time even if I'll be late for work. Kind of crazy, but he did it. And he spent his quiet time with the Lord, and then he left to rush to his job. And usually if you're late during the communism, that was pretty bad. Probably the second time you will be fired, and it wasn't fun. So he got there, and at the gate where he was not the only one late, fortunately. And he was waiting in line, and everybody was asking for their kind of work permits. So they pull like the stamp of being late to work. And when God, he's telling me, he just prayed, Lord, help me not to see my work permit. And when his third came, they just, okay, go ahead, and didn't take his work permit to put the delayed stamp on it. I was like, thank you, Jesus. And a lot of stories like that when God really worked and showed his power and care for his children.
Right. Last minute, what's the future for you guys? Do you plan to stay in the U.S. or go back to Romania to serve? I know you called to the Lord, and of course that may be, you know, you're just seeking the Lord right now, but what's the future for the Parvu and the rescue family here?
Right. That's the hardest question ever, because everybody asks us that, what's your plan after you graduate? The answer is, we don't know yet. We want to stay sensitive to the God's will and God's call for our lives. And if he doesn't speak to us to go back to Romania, we might spend a few more years here in the States. So we never know. I mean, you have a lot of Romanians here in the States. And every time when I meet someone from Romania in the States, my heart is just filled with joy. It's like, I can speak Romanian with somebody, and that's amazing. And I know that a lot of them came here to make money, because that's man's desire. Go, you know, wealthy country and work hard and make money, but that's not what life is all about. So I pray hard that God will bring my way Romanians that are here and are lost, and I will be able to share the gospel with them and just minister to them. And that's so strong with my heart, and God is working on that. I can tell you that right now. Actually, last week on Thursday, we went to First Baptist Covington, because Helga was asked to play the violin for a rehearsal. And guess what happened? We met the Romanian lady who was playing also the violin. Her name is Simona, and we got in touch with her, we talked to her, we changed Facebook IDs, and hopefully soon we'll get together and we'll have the opportunity to minister to her and to her family. And that's so exciting for my heart.
Wonderful. How can we pray for you? How can we pray for you and your family?
First of all, to understand clearly what God wants from us. It's not fun to be confused. So we want to understand clearly from God what's our next step in his will. Because we might have amazing plans, but we want God's will to be done in our lives. Also, to help us to finish strong on our degrees, and also we really enjoy serving. I forgot to tell you that we did worship. I did worship at First Baptist Madisonville, where Pastor Jerry is pastor, and we love this church, we love these people, and we are so honored to be part of this amazing church. And we also want to pray for God to strengthen us so we continue to love on them and serve them with a sincere heart and with passion.
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you what, we'll pray for you at the end of the service. We're going to continue with the concert, and they're going to sing a Romanian carol, and then they're going to do a Christmas song in three languages, all right? I don't think Cajun is one of them, but anyway, they're going to do that here at this moment, all right?
Okay, before we will sing this Romanian carol, I would like to ask my wife. I will say the words in Romanian, and my wife will translate them in English, so you can understand what we are singing about, okay? Ascultați cu toții cum vă colindăm.
Everybody hear how we carol tonight?
Pe Iisus Mesia azi îl prezentăm.
Jesus the Messiah we today present to you.
A venit din slavă de la Tatăl Sfânt.
He came from his glory from the Holy Father.
Și a luat trup de moarte aici pe pământ.
And he took a death body here on earth.
Vrem azi să cunoaștem pruncul minunat.
We would like today to get to know the wonderful baby.
Care prin iubire viața ne-a schimbat.
Who through love our life he has changed.
El e rege veșnic, Domn și Dumnezeu.
He is eternal King, Lord and Savior.
A venit să moară doar de dragul meu.
He's come to die just for my sake.
Hope you enjoy it. Colinda, 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 Colinda.
Ascultați cu toții cum vă colindăm. Pe Iisus Mesia azi îl prezentăm. A venit din slavă de la Tatăl Sfânt și-a luat trup de moarte aici pe pământ. A venit din slavă de la Tatăl Sfânt și-a luat trup de moarte aici pe pământ.
changed all of history. What happened in that little remote village, I've been there, it's a little bitty town. What happened there in that place changed all of life and all of history. Because you see, what happened in that little town of Bethlehem, and really it was just a little town, God came down. God wrapped his heart in human flesh. God contracted to a span. God became a man. The theological word is the incarnation. God became flesh. And the Bible says the Word became flesh. The Word refers to Jesus. The Word became flesh and what? Dwelt among us. Came to live with us. Moved in with us, as one translation says. He came to be where we are so that one day we could be where he was and now is in heaven. It would be improper for us to sing about Jesus and have incredible testimony of people who for some crazy reason think it is a good thing to follow Jesus even when you're persecuted. Even when there are those who would attack you, literally, physical persecution, who would try to hurt you and would keep you from rising in life, even a job promotion, as with Andre's dad. But apparently they met Jesus, and he changed their lives. And they believe he's worth it. He's worth it, and he is. And what happened in Bethlehem affects us today in Benico, Ponchatoula, Madisonville, Hammond, Robert, wherever you're from, the U.S., but also in Romania, and every other country, and every city, every state, every village, every little spot in the road, Jesus makes a difference. And if you don't know Jesus, oh, you know about him. Most everybody around the U.S. has heard about him at some level. Not all, but most have. There are many around the world that have not heard the name of Jesus, but most people around here heard about Jesus. You know about him, but it's different of knowing about him in your head and having him in your heart. And I was that kind of person many years ago. I was religious, went to church, thought everything was good because I tried to live a moral life. Felt like I was a good person. But I found out I really wasn't that good because I was a sinner. It separated me from a holy God. And then I recognized it wasn't religion, it wasn't being a church member, and it wasn't trying to live a good life that got me right with God. You know what I found? It was trusting in this Jesus, born in Bethlehem, who grew to be a man, lived a perfect life, and as a result could be the perfect sacrifice for our sins, because the Bible says the soul that sinneth what? It must die. The wage of sin is, and not just physical death, that's spiritual death, separation from God, because our sins separate us from him. And he can't let us into heaven, because what kind of place is heaven? Perfect place. And if he lets us in with our sin, what happens? We make it imperfect. So our sin has to be gotten rid of. We got to get rid of it. How can we do it? We can't. We can't. That's the bad news. On our own. But the good news is, because of what Jesus did on the cross, he paid for our sin. And because he shed his blood that will cover and remove our sin, then we, if we turn from sin and ask him to come live in our hearts and save our souls, then we can be right with God. And that's the reason Jesus came and was born of a virgin in that little town of Bethlehem. As Christ was born in that stable and placed in a manger, Christ can come into your heart and you can be born again. Amen. Because Jesus said you must be born again. Start all over with God. And I want to give you that opportunity. So, preacher, well, what do I have to do? Very simply, turn from your sin, admit your sin, we're all sinners, and trust Christ, what he did on the cross when he paid for your sin, and ask him to come take control of your life. And I'll give you that opportunity because I can't think of a better time of the year to trust Jesus than at his birthday. And you can have your second birthday to be born again. What we're going to do is we're going to pray together. Now, just saying a prayer won't make you a Christian. Just the words themselves. But if it's from your heart, sincerely, if you will turn from sin and trust Christ and cry out to Him, He will come into your heart. And then what we're going to do, they're going to continue to play Little Town of Bethlehem, and I'm going to give an opportunity. I'm going to step down here, and if you trust Jesus and want to let it be known to some here today, we want to encourage you and help you in your next steps for Jesus. And I'm going to stand up here. Our associate pastor will come here. And you can come visit with us. Or if you want to talk on a more personal level, any spiritual decision, we want to be available during this invitation time. That's what we call it. And we invite you to know Christ and to make any decision for Him. So what are we going to do? We're going to bow our heads. And then I will lead you in a prayer. And if your desire is to make certain that you're born again and you have Jesus, what happened in Bethlehem is personal for you, then I'll give you that opportunity. Would you bow your heads with me now? Everyone, heads bowed, eyes closed, no one looking around. If you want to trust Christ, make certain where you stand with Him. If you have a question mark, if you know for certain you've never truly been born again, would you say something like this? You can pray out loud, or you can whisper it, or silently speak to the Lord. It's something like this. Lord, I admit that I'm a sinner. Please forgive me. Thank you, Jesus, for dying on the cross. Pay for my sin. And right now, I want to turn from my sin. And I want to ask you to come into my life. I know that you rose from the dead. Because you conquered death, you can give me life. And just say to it, I turn from my sin. I trust what you did on the cross. And then say to him, Jesus, come into my heart. Save my soul. And He'll do it. And you can start over with God. As Jesus was born in Bethlehem, you can be born again in Bethlehem. And if you pray and receive Jesus, let me welcome the family of God. We'd like to do it personally to know who our new family members are, so that's why we're going to give this public invitation. And also because everyone Jesus called in the New Testament, He called them publicly, no secret followers of Jesus, no secret disciples. And so we want to give you that opportunity. Maybe you may want to be a part of this church. You may be attending here, or you may be at another church. We just want to encourage you in your next steps in living for Jesus. And so let me pray for you, and then I'll invite you to come. Heavenly Father, thank you for this wonderful time we have had together with testimony in song and testimony in word. And thank you for this precious family from Romania. And Lord, thank you for them leading us in this last song here that's going to be part of the invitation, Little Town of Bethlehem, to remind us that it all happened there that makes a difference for where we are now. And for those who have made personal commitments right now or maybe in the past or want to do so with myself or our associate pastor here, Lord, I pray you'd help them to do so as led by your Holy Spirit. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask you to stand with me now. And I'm going to be down here. Associate pastor's going to be. Brother Jerry, why don't you just stand over here? Brother Jerry St. Pierre, pastor in Madisonville. If anyone wants to come to Christ, we're going to be available to you.
Silence now, holy now.
us tonight. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Do you like my Romanian friends? Aren't they a blessing? I love them. Thank you so much. I'm going to go ahead and have a seat. I'm going to ask Pastor Jerry St. Pierre to come and lead us in a word of prayer and dismiss us. And Andre asked for prayer for he and his family. And this man has been their pastor, and he brought them to First Madisonville, and they're serving just right down the road. Y'all know what I'm talking about? Right down here on the left, on the way. And so this was one of my students as well. And he's done well. And he was one of my best preachers, I'm telling you. He is a Cajun boy from Slidell, I want you to know. And he is a good, godly young man. And really, he preached for Senior Preaching Week at the seminary a few years ago when he graduated. And have you shared with the church what's happening here?
Yes.
Can you share with us what you're about to do?
Sure.
Okay, tell us what you're about to do, your next assignment for the Lord.
Well, I'm an Air Force chaplain, and the Air Force has some needs that... Can you hear me now? I'm used to the wireless at my church, but I'm an Air Force Reserve chaplain, and I'm uniquely qualified to meet some of the needs that our Air Force has, and they've asked me to step up and do some of those, meet some of those needs. And so we'll be reassigned to Boston, Massachusetts, in that area, for a three-year tour at Hanscom Air Force Base to take care of our nation's airmen who are standing at the gates of freedom, ensuring that they remain open.
So, I pray the Lord will use you, brother. But would you pray for
his
family
and pray for
us here as we dismiss? And by the way, we are going to have a finger food fellowship. And we are going to go to the gym over here. And I told them a while ago that everything I eat is with my fingers. So anyway, you know, it's nothing different. But anyway, you are all invited to be a part. Yes, Brother Olin, do you have a word?
You have to take them an offering, brother?
No, we are going to take care of them with an honorarium. But here's what I'll say to you. If you want to bless them further, we had monies in the budget to take care of this. But if you want to bless them further, you are welcome to let me know that you would like to, and we will get that to them, all right? And they are students. They're poor seminary students, and they're very hungry. They're going to come eat with their fingers as well. So you'll get to meet them and visit with them over in the gym. And those of you that are guests here, you can follow us. It's out this door and just immediately to my right, to your left, in the building, back building here. And we're going to have a wonderful setup, and we'll have some goodies, Christmas goodies. I always like Christmas treats, don't you? Well, I like eating treats, but I really like the Christmas treats, all right? So we're going to have that time together. So again, thank you so much, family. You blessed our hearts, and we are so grateful for you and for your ministry. And I appreciate this man as well and the new assignment God has given him as he works with our military and shares with him as a chaplain. So God bless you, Jerry, and dismiss us in prayer.
Yes, sir. And Father, we just come to you right now thankful for your son, Jesus Christ, who changes lives. And Lord, our Romanian, not just friends, but brothers and sisters. My own brother in Christ that I have a privilege of serving with. Father, I pray that you would use him, that you would use this family, Helga and Maria, Lord, that you would increase their ministry. Lord, that they would have the great privilege of touching many lives with the truth of the gospel that is eternal, that bears eternal fruit. And Lord, that they would remain not only faithful laborers, but Lord, fervent laborers in your kingdom. Because truly the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. So Lord, bless their ministry at First Baptist of Madisonville. Thank you for everything you're doing there, the fire that you brought into the life of that church. Lord, may your hand continue to be upon them too. Lord, here at Bedeco, Father, we pray your blessings on this congregation. Lord, use them to bring your gospel to the nations all over the world. And Lord, thank you for a wonderful time together with fellow brothers and sisters. Bless this time of fellowship and the food. We love you. In Christ's name, amen.